Engineering College, Vaishali. I would like to request, I would like to present my gratitude and thanks to respected Ritesh sir for accepting our invitation and delivering a small talk for our students. On this note, I would like to call respected principal sir to officially welcome Ritesh sir and to invite sir for the talk. Sir.
Thank you, Upadhyay. Good morning to all of you. Subject expert and resource person of this webinar, Dr. Ritesh Kumar Badhai, Assistant Professor, BIT Mesa, and of course, BIT Campus, Patna. Faculty Coordinator, Professor Vivek Upadhyay and Professor Gaurav Ghosh of Electrical Engineering. Student Coordinator, Mr. Vinesh Bhaskar, Manu Srivastava, Tawfir Alam, and Adarsh Kumar of this institute. Our faculty members and dear students. A very warm welcome to all of you in this national level webinar on fundamentals of satellite communication system. So before going into the present scenario of this type of satellite communication, let us dive deep into the rich, glorious and technologically advanced past that our country enjoyed. All of you know that internet satellite existed in days of Mahabharata, 3067 BC. How could Sanjayda give a detailed account and description to the blind king about the battle of Kurukshetra? It means internet was there, the satellite and the technology was there in this country at that time. The era of Mahabharata, India was top in the technology, but somehow in the middle it got lost. Then if you go ahead, you might have, I think you might have heard about Meghdoot. Meghdoot is a poem written by Kalidas in 4th century. And there is a very beautiful story. The theme of this poem is on love, separation and desire for reunion from the beloved wife of Yaksha. The Meghdoot, this poem, tells about the Yaksha, a servant of Kuber. You know Kuber, god of wealth, who was banished by his master Kuber from Alka city, city of gods in Himalayan mountain for a period of 1 year and to live on another hill after he was grossly neglectful of his duty. मैं थोड़ा इसको ऐसे बता दूं कि कुबेर जो हम लोगों के धन के देवता माने जाते हैं उनका नौकर यक्ष था. उसके ड्यूटी के नेग्लिजेंस में कुबेर ने उसे एक साल के लिए उस शहर से निर्वासित करके कहा कि तुम कहीं बाहर दूर पहाड़ पे रहो. एंड दिस कॉज टू गेट सेपरेटेड फ्रॉम हिज वाइफ एंड दिस कर्स वाज स्पेशली हेवी टू बियर बिकॉज ऑफ दिस सेपरेशन. ही विशेस टू सेंड हिज वाइफ ए मैसेज अबाउट हिज हेल्थ एंड अनचेंज लव फॉर हर. इन हिज डिस्परेट स्टेट ऑफ माइंड ही आस्क्ड an inert object that is a cloud that was available before him to function as a messenger and bring the news to his beloved wife, hoping it would delight her heart. Aur usne badal pe apne patra aur apne je samvedanaon ko likh karke apni patni tak pahunchane laga. Ye ek kavya hai jo Meghdoot jo Kalidas ne likha hai aur aaj hum usko now we see as a cloud computing. And in the memory of that, Meghdoot card services was introduced by the Department of Post Government of India in September 2022. And again, the Center for Development of Advanced Computing, Bangalore, launched a Meghdoot software. That Meghdoot simply is a cloud messenger. This was our past history of this type of communication using cloud. And Sanjay got Divya Drishti to tell battle what is going on in Mahabharata. And this was our past history and past, I think, a glorious history, scientific history. Now, in present scenario, we all of know that satellites are simply man-made objects put into orbit and provide modern convenience and broadcast entertainment. In television, we see the use of satellite in telephones. Satellite provide in-flight phone communication on airplanes and often main conduit of wireless communication for rural areas and areas where phone lines are damaged after a disaster. In navigation, satellite-based navigation system like GPS enable anyone with a handheld receiver to determine the location within a few meters. In business and finance, communication satellites have the ability to rapidly communicate between a number of widely dispersed locations. This is an important tool allowing big manufacturing companies and departments to perform inventory management, provide instant credit and authorization, and automated teller banking services to even small towns, and video conferencing for international corporations as we are doing today. In weather, satellites provide meteorologists with the ability to see weather on a global scale, allowing them to follow the effects of phenomena like volcanic eruption, burning of gas and oil fields, to the development of large systems like hurricanes. In climate and environmental monitoring, satellites are some of the best sources of data for climate change research. Satellites monitor ocean temperature and prevailing currents. Data acquired by satellite-borne radars were able to show sea levels have been rising by how much mm in a year or in the last decades. Imagine satellites can measure the changing size of glaciers, which is difficult to do from the ground due to remoteness and darkness of the polar regions. For the safety point of view, Earth observation satellites can monitor ocean and wind current, as well as the extent of forest fires, oil spills, and airborne pollution. In terms of space science, before the space age, astrophysicists were limited to studying the universe via ground-based telescopes, and so cloud only, and they could only use information about the parts of electromagnetic spectrum that penetrated the Earth's atmosphere. Many of the most interesting phenomena are best studied at the frequencies that are best or only accessible from the space satellite telescope have been critical to understanding phenomena like pulsars and black holes, as well as measuring the age of the universe. And you know, the Hubble Space Telescope is the most valuable astronomical tool ever built. Now I come to how even plants and animals communicate with themselves. One of the research I have recently read in the Nature magazine, that when you inhale the sweet smell of freshly, mown grass or cut flowers. Hello. Hello.
Voice is audible, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Cut flowers, what you are actually smelling is the plant's distress call. It is the plant way of crying out for help. And the scientist known as James Cahill, he has studied on the plant. And he reported that the scent attracts its insects that will eat the pest currently munching on their plant bodies. मतलब हुआ है कि plant पे जो आप जो 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 insects वगैरह जो भी उनका जब attack होता है, तो उससे बचने के लिए भी वो एक signal भेजते हैं. और उस signal से, जैसे example के रूप में उन्होंने डाला है कि the wild tobacco plant can identify a hornworm caterpillary by its saliva. And when attacked by this caterpillar, the tobacco plant emits a chemical signal that appeals to the insect's enemies. And within hours, caterpillar predators like the big-eyed bug show up, ideally driving the pest away. वो तुरंत अपना सिग्नल भेजता है और इससे जो उसपे जो जिन इंसेक्ट्स का अटैक होता है, जिससे वो हार्म हो सकते, उससे बचने के लिए उसके एनिमी तुरंत पहुंच जाते हैं और उस इंसेक्ट को तुरंत वहां से हटा देते हैं। मैं इसको इस कॉन्टेक्स्ट में कह रहा हूं कि प्लांट्स हाउ बीज जो मधुमक्खी है वो आपस में कैसे कम्युनिकेट करते हैं। तो आज तो सैटेलाइट कम्युनिकेशन की बात हम कर ही रहे हैं, लेकिन हमें नेचर से भी सीखना है कि हाउ इफेक्टिवली दे कम्युनिकेट विद इन देमसेल्फ, हाउ इवन प्लांट्स कैन कम्युनिकेट विद अमंग देमसेल्फ, how insects communicate among themselves without saying verbally anything, without expressing in verbal mode. They communicate well with each other. So the time has come to study all this type of communication, and that is called natural communication, and what technology we can develop so that we can use this type of technology without using so much instrument, without using so much machines, without using so much power consumption. So we have to do a lot in this area also. And now I'm not going to take so much time. I hope that this webinar will benefit our students. On behalf of GEC Vaisali, I convey my best wishes for a very successful webinar. With this keynote address, I extend a very warm welcome to our resource person, and I request her now to enlighten our faculty members and the students through your scholarly speech. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So, good morning, everyone. Before we start today's webinar, first of all, I would like to thank respected Professor Anand Kumar, Principal of GEC Vaisali, Professor Vivek Upadhyay, Professor in charge of EC, and the Professor Gaurav Ghosh, Faculty Coordinator of this webinar, and all other faculty members, students, and also student coordinators for organizing this webinar and giving me opportunity to interact with the student and the faculty on this topic. And again, I would like to thank Principal Sir for giving this nice historical and experimental practical introduction of satellite communication and wireless communication. Now I'm going to share. This slide is visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay. So today's topic is the fundamental of satellite communication system. We are already aware about the satellite communication. We are already aware of the satellite communication and some basic idea about the satellite communication. And basically, the satellite communication are the artificial satellites which are very useful in the telecommunication for the wireless data transmission or wireless data communication. In the today's era, we cannot assume any communication or any services, especially wireless services, without satellites. Basically, the satellites are nothing but these are the repeaters which just receive and retransmit our signals from one point to another point. That in maybe term of point-to-point communication, or it may be in term of the broadcasting. So today we are receiving many television signals, we are receiving the international calls, wireless calls, and navigation services, and many more, which is only possible due to the satellite communication. This era is begin after the World War II, because that World War II gave us two different technologies. After that, we are able to transmit, or we are able to launch the satellites. One is the missile technology, which just useful for launching of the satellites. And another one is the microwave communication. Because the microwave communication is a very narrow beam communication, which can be transmitted up to the higher or larger distance without, in the free space, without attenuation. So these two technologies are combined and provide us the satellite communication, and we are using this communication in our daily life, like in televisions, in the mobile communication, in navigations, in weather analysis, weather monitoring, security purposes, military applications, some telemedicine services, and many more. So, agenda of today's topic is this way: that the introduction followed by satellite services, satellite orbital parameters, type of the orbits, then the law associated with the rotation of the satellites, effect of the solar eclipse, and then the orbital inclination and the management of the orientation of satellite, that means the satellite station keeping, then how satellites are launched to space, and the satellite stabilization followed by some mathematical analysis of wireless communication, and then some earth equipment and satellite equipment. So that term satellite, the satellite term is basically originated from the Latin word satellite, where the meaning of the satellite is the attendant. As you may know that, the attendant is continuously available along with his master and providing the whatever service master required, that attendant will provide to him. Similar fashion, that satellite is continuously orbiting our Earth and providing the essential information related to weather, communication, and navigation in many modules. The satellite is simply the body that moves around the larger body compared to that one, and the mathematically it's rotate on the predicted path, which is known as the trajectory. So satellite are always moving on one particular path, on predefined path, and providing their services to any of the point or any of the place in the world, that area, maybe in the rural, urban, or anywhere. And in case of the terrestrial communication, this satellite communication is having very large advantages. Like in case of the terrestrial communication, some optical fiber is cover up the some advantages of satellite communication, but still that optical fiber approach or optical fiber is not available for urban areas or everywhere in the world. But satellite communication or satellite data, we can access from any point, any area, or any kind of situation. So it's better compared to the terrestrial communication. Now we just go to the satellite network. Satellite network contains, basically satellite network not involve only the wireless part. It also requires the terrestrial communication. Without terrestrial network, we cannot transfer all the data to satellite, because all the networks, all the transmitters are not capable to transmit that much high frequency that can be directly communicated with the satellite. So many of the modules are connected with the terrestrial network, and then through the terrestrial network, we can interconnect with the Earth station, and through the Earth station, that data is transmitted or received from the satellite. As we can see that in this particular network, that voice data, video data, or simple numeric or analytical data that can be connected through the terrestrial network, like mobile, computer, internet, and television data are connected with one terrestrial network. And then that terrestrial network is connected with the Earth station. But that Earth station uplink all the frequencies and transmit to the satellite. And basically, satellite is not generating are not adding any signal. That is just the repeater, just like a microwave repeaters we are using on the Earth. It just receives any signal, amplify, and then retransmit to another point. Now it depends that communication is one-way communication or two-way communication. Like that will be point-to-point communication or broadcasting communication. Based on that, that communication will be available for transmitter as well as receiver. So on both the side, there will be two users, user A and user B. User A is the transmitter, user B is receiver. So user A is transmitting their data on the uplink frequency. That uplink frequency signal is received by the satellite, and then that will be down converted, amplified, and retransmitted to the second user. We are going to beginning of the satellite communication, or we said the history of the satellite communication. So the journey of satellite communication is basically start from the 1945. In 1945, one author, that Arthur Clarke, published his one article, basically published his book, science fiction book, where he just explained how any artificial object can be rotated around the other object. And after around 12 years later, that theory, Dixon theory is practically done by the Russia, USRR, that is Russia. And he launched first satellite to the space, which is known as the Sputnik. Later on, that name is given to Sputnik 1. So first satellite launched by the Russia USSR in 1957, 4th October 1957, which is known as the Sputnik. And weight of that satellite is around 83 kg. And that is the low Earth orbit satellite. And for the purpose of the atmospheric analysis or atmospheric study. The time duration of this satellite was 3 months, but actually this satellite was active for the 6 years. So that predefined time is 3 months, but that will be active for the long time. Now the first communication satellite or commercial satellite, which is capable to receive and transmit any signal, that was the early bird, which was the launched by US organization Intelsat 1. And that early bird was 34 kg in weight, and that was the first GEO satellite that communicate any signal from satellite to ground station. That means that early bird is capable to receive any signal from Earth, then retransmit to the satellite. Retransmit to the another point. The coverage of this early bird was US and some European countries. The satellite was operated for around 4 years and deactivated in 1969. This satellite is having around 240 channel, voice channels and one television channel at that time. And that services is owned by these around 52 countries. Now there's some more satellites, almost some more important satellites, which are originated from 1957. So first satellite in 1957, that was, as you know, as I told, that Sputnik. Later on, that was indicated as Sputnik 1, because immediately after the Sputnik, Russia again launched their second satellite, Sputnik 2. That's why that nomenclature is 1 and 2. So in 4th October 1957, Russia launched its first satellite, Sputnik 1, and then just after Sputnik 2. And the America then just launched after some 6 or 7 months later, that Explorer 1. And his first telecommunication satellite was the ISKOR. So basically, ISKOR was launched in 58. So difference between the ISKOR and early bird was that ISKOR has just transmitted the recorded system, a recorded signal. One recorded signal feed to the ISKOR, and then that ISKOR broadcast that recorded system. But early bird was capable to receive and transmit any signal. So early bird was the first commercial satellite which is capable to receive as well as transmit. Thereafter, first meteorological satellite was by Russia, is the Explorer 7. In the continuously after 50s, 60s, that space war is started between Russia and USA, and many satellites are launched in between 60 to 70s. So in 60s, the first successful passive satellite is ECO 1. Passive satellite, that means such kind of satellite, we just receive signal, amplify and retransmit. That satellite cannot do anything along with that particular signal. And the active satellites are such kind of satellites which receive any signal, down-convert it, demodulate and rectify if any error or noises occur during the uplink, and then again amplify, up-convert it and transmit it to another system. So response of active satellite is much better than passive satellite, or you can say that the quality of active satellite signals are much better than passive satellite signals. NASA's first satellite is Explorer 8. Then the first man on the space in 1961, Yuri Gagarin from the Russia. After that, the first telephone communication and television broadcasting via the satellite is done by the ECO 1. And then the first telecommunication satellite for real-time active, not for the delayed signal or recorded signal, that was the Telstar. Then in that same category, Telstar 2 is also launched. And after that, the first geosynchronous satellite. Geosynchronous satellite, that means some kind of orbit which is synchronized along with the rotation of the Earth. That will be discussed later on the orbits. So the first geosynchronous satellite was the early bird, which is very useful in case of the broadcasting. And the history of Indian satellite is started with the Aryabhatta. So the first Indian satellite is named Aryabhatta, which was launched in 19th April 1975 from Russian launching site, and it was made and assembled by the organization known as the ISRO. ISRO designed, assembled this particular satellite, but launching facility was not available in India at that time, so that was launched from the Russia. And after that, India launched its first indigenous satellite in 1981 by its Rohini launching satellite, Rohini, and the Apple in 81. Now, comes to the advantages of satellite communication over the terrestrial network. So, satellite communication are good in many aspects compared to the terrestrial networks. Like, satellite communication cost is the independent from the distance of the users. That means, it doesn't matter where is your receiving user or where is our broadcasting receivers. That means, if any satellite is transmitting any television signal from any satellite, then that cost will be similar for the Delhi users, for Patna users, and Ranchi users, and all. Because the coverage area of satellite is very large compared to terrestrial network, so within that coverage area, transmission cost will be similar. That cost will only increase when our transmission between the intra satellites. So, because suppose this is the satellite, and this is the Earth, and this one is the coverage area of the satellite. So this is the coverage area. So it doesn't matter if you are here, 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 or any point. Then transmission cost and almost time delay will be almost similar between all these points. So first thing is the distance independent cost provided by the satellites. While in case of the terrestrial network, that cost will be different. Just like your local calls and ISD calls and the STD calls. Because terrestrial network involves longer and longer wire and longer network for the longer distance. Next one is the fixed broadcasting cost. Fixed broadcasting cost means in case of broadcasting, that satellite doesn't matter, the broadcaster does not affected by the number of receiver, a signal does not affected by the number of receivers, because similar amount of power density is transmitted from the satellite, and multiple number of users can be receive that particular signal. Just example, suppose any transmitter is transmitting 15 watt of power. So that 15 watt of power, that will be continuously available for the complete coverage area. So any number of receiver can be receive that particular signal. It depends on their on sensitivity. Suppose signal strength is lower at any point, then receiver's sensitivity, a highly sensitive receiver can receive that particular signal. So if number of users are increases, that broadcasting cost that will not be increased. If number of users will increase, then that will be beneficial for the transmitter or broadcaster. Next is the higher capacity. As we already know that satellite communication is occur over the microwave signals, and the microwave frequencies are very high frequencies. Large spectrum is available along with the microwave frequencies. Due to that large band, we can accommodate larger number of users, or we can accommodate better quality or better bandwidth of signal for the broadcasting or communication. So along with the wider bandwidth, number of users are increases in case of satellite communication. Next is the error rate. Error rate is very lower in case of satellite communication, because we are not having any interconnection path like wires. We are not having any connecting modules. So data is not lost during that connection or joints, and very low error are included or occur during the transmission. The chances of bit error rate is around 1 bit. 1 bit out of 10 to the power 6 bits. Yes, out of 10 to the power 6 bit, there is a chance of 1 bit can be changed or error. So error rate is very lower in case of satellite communication, and the diverse user network capacity is available along with the satellite communication, because satellite communication can be provided at the rural areas, urban areas, hilly areas, mountain areas, and anywhere on the globe, as well as it's also compatible with the terrestrial network, so that satellite signal can be transmitted through also through the terrestrial network. Now, some disadvantages also associated with this satellite communication. First one is the launching of satellite into orbit is very costly, because all the orbits are at very higher distance, more than 150 kilometer to 42,000 kilometer from the center of the Earth or from the surface of the Earth. So this large distance is involved in the satellite communication. That's why launching is very costly. For second generation satellite launching, that launching cost of any satellite is around $200 to $250 million. While the designing cost of satellite is very low compared to this launching, if second generation satellite cost is around $35 million designing cost, while the launching cost is approximately $200 to $250 million. So launching is higher compared to designing cost. So due to this higher launching cost, the satellite service is little costly compared to the terrestrial network, because in the communication and total costing, these two costings are added, and after that, the satellite spectrum is provided to the broadcasters or users. Next one is the propagation delay of satellite system, which is the more than the conventional terrestrial network. Due to this larger distance, that signal is delayed from point A to point B, because suppose we are talking about the geosynchronous satellite or broadcasting satellite, so that height of the broadcasting satellite from surface of the Earth is around 35,786 kilometers from surface of the Earth. Okay, so that transmission is going from 35,786 kilometer upward and then retransmitted back to the 35,786 kilometer downward. That is a more than 70,000 kilometer. So during the 70,000 kilometer, the transmission delay is higher. So that transmission delay is approximately 250 milliseconds for the round trip communication. Round trip communication is uplink and downlink. So we cannot say that through the satellite we are receiving actually live data. That will be delayed by the 250 milliseconds, right? So propagation delay is little higher in case of the satellite communication compared to the terrestrial network. And third is the difficulty to provide any repairing activity if any of the module is not working in case of the satellite. Suppose a mixer or RF amplifier or IF amplifier or any decoder or detector module is not working, a failure due to the any condition, then it's not possible to repair that particular link or repair that repairing services cannot be provided on that satellite. So that's why to resolve this particular problem, in many of the communication channels, we are providing the one additional link, which is known as the just like a stepney. Like the most of the cases, mixer is having maximum probability of failures. With such devices which are having lump components or that nonlinear components, just like a diode, transistors, and other, that are having the maximum possibility of failure. So for that particular components, we are providing the redundancy path or stepney path for the communication, so that that can be controlled by the TTCM stations, and that alternate path can be provided, because repairing is not possible in case of satellite. Another disadvantage of satellite communication is the free space path loss or path loss during the transmission. As I already told that the distance between the communication points is very higher in case of satellite communication. That's why the propagation loss or propagation distance, propagation path loss is also larger in case of satellite, because received power in case of the any kind of wireless communication, that will be inversely proportional to the square of distance. When distance increases, then the received power strength is going to drop. It's going to be drop. So received power is very small. And in case of satellite communication, we are always dealing with the very low power, very low received power, or very low received signal to noise strength. Some of the applications of satellite communication are this. That a satellite can be used for the radio broadcasting or voice broadcasting. It also can be useful for in the DTH television broadcasting, such as the DTH. Internet applications, such as providing internet connections, data transfer, GPS services, internet surfing, etc. Military applications for navigation, missile guidance, and many more. Remote sensing applications, weather condition monitoring, and minings, and many more applications are involved in the satellite. So some services offered by the satellites are like this. Satellite is capable to provide basically four different type of services. One is the fixed satellite service, FSS, which covers the link between the satellite and fixed transmitting module or receiving modules, just like your DTH. The fixed satellite services like television broadcasting, where transmitting station is, sorry, receiving station is fixed on the earth, not moving along with the rotation of satellite, are not moving in the real time. That will be fixed with respect to the satellite. Another one is the mobile services, which covers the links station that may be in motion, just like the mobile ships, aircrafts, and land vehicles, where receiving module, a transmitting module, is moving with respect to the satellite position. Third one is the broadcast services, where the receiver as well as transmitter, that means satellite and receiving station, is fixed. So in this particular case, broadcasting or audio broadcasting comes in this category. Last one is the inter-satellite services. Because one satellite is not capable to provide the coverage over the complete globe, so there are many satellites are used to provide the global coverage. So suppose if you want to initiate any call between India to Australia, so one satellite cannot provide coverage between India to Australia. So we require the intra-satellite communication between India and Australia. That means we will transmit one signal to satellite. The satellite will interconnect with another satellite, which broadcasting over the Australia, and that will be broadcast to Australia or connect to the Australian ones. Now the segments used in the satellite communication. So basically, satellite communication is categorized in two parts: ground segment and the space segment. So in case of the ground segment, all the terrestrial network, all the transmitting stations are coming under the category of the ground stations, like VSAT, AMSAT, GPS transmitter, Earth station transmitter, or satellite mobiles, DTH, and all. So all these ground station transmitters, a ground station receiver, a transmitter, comes under the category of ground segment. And the another segment is the space segment, where satellites receiving system comes under this category. That means receiver of satellite, transmitter of satellite, amplifiers, antennas, and solar arrays, solar panels, and that housing of the satellite and all. Along with that, one more part which comes under the space segment, which is known as the TTC or TTCR. Telemetry Tracking Command, or sometimes it's also known as the Telemetry Tracking Command and Monitoring. This part is basically originated at the Earth, but comes under the category of space segment. Because the purpose of this TTCM is for the monitoring, a health monitoring of the satellite, a tracking the position of the satellite. That's why this is under the category of space segment. This TTCM network, a TTCM ground station, is not involved in any kind of broadcasting or communication services. This is only responsible or only take care of the satellite's health, or just monitoring the health of the satellites. Just observe the position of satellite, just observe the, what is the temperature of satellite, critical voltage and current of the satellites, and link analysis of the satellite and all. That means VK Sena, it is the doctor of the satellite. No. Some terminologies or some parameters, orbital parameters we use in the satellite communication, that apogee, perigee. Just assume this is the orbit of a satellite. Most of the orbits are elliptical orbits, and some of the orbits are circular orbits. So suppose this is the orbit of the satellite, then after this, we will discuss the Kepler's law. As per the Kepler's law, that Earth is situated at one of the focus of the ellipse. So Earth is situated at this particular focus. Then one point of this orbit, that will be near point. Another point of this orbit, that will be far point. So that nearest point is known as the perigee, which is the near to the Earth surface. And the farthest point from the Earth, which is known as the apogee point. So these two points are apogee and perigee, and the line joining these two points is known as the line of apsite. That means line passing through the center of the Earth and connecting apogee and perigee, that is the line of apsite. Basically, we say that the major axis, that is the line of apsite. After that, in case of satellite communication, there are two type of nodes. One is the ascending node and the descending nodes. So basically, these nodes are what? These nodes are the intersection point of orbit, satellite orbit, and the equatorial plane of the satellite. So equatorial plane, that means what? Equatorial plane, that is particularly passes through the center of the Earth, that passes through the that passes from the center of the Earth, like London. London is situated on the equatorial orbit, or equatorial plane. So the angular separation between intersection between that equatorial orbit and satellite orbit, just like suppose this is Earth and this is my orbital plane where satellite is rotating, and this is the equatorial plane. Equatorial plane means which is passes through the center. So the this intersection point of orbital plane and the equatorial plane, this is known as the ascending and descending node. Obviously, that equatorial plane and orbital plane will intersect at two points, one on the front side, suppose this is the Earth, so one on the front side, one on the back side. So that front side, when we are moving from south to north direction, so points which comes in between the south to north motion, that will be known as the ascending point, and the point of intersection, which is on the second side, when satellite moving from north to south, this is known as the descending point, ascending and descending. And the line joining these two points, obviously this lining will pass through the center of the Earth. So lining to join ascending node and descending node is known as the line of nodes. Then the argument of perigee, this is the angle from ascending node to perigee. Here is the ascending node. So ascending node to perigee point, that is known as the argument of perigee. So all the calculations or all the inclination values, angular values are calculated on the ascending point and between the equatorial orbit and the orbital orbit. Sorry, a satellite's orbital. Place. Like the inclination angle of any orbit is calculated at the ascending node, and that inclination is between the equatorial orbit and the inclined orbit, and that can be measured at the ascending node. This angular separation between these two planes is known as the inclination angle of orbital plane. So based on that inclination angle, orbital plane is also classified in four types. One is the equatorial orbit. If our satellite is orbiting over the just parallel to the equatorial plane, that means the satellite is orbiting just parallel to the equatorial plane, that means it's just parallel to this equatorial orbit, and that inclination angle will be 0 or 180 degree. So if inclination angle is 0 or 180 degree, then that orbit will be known as the equatorial orbit. Next one is the polar orbit. Polar orbit means when the inclination angle is higher than 0 degrees and it's around 90 degrees, exactly 90 degrees, then that will be polar orbit. That means this kind of orbit. Where satellite is rotating between north and south. But very rare satellites are orbiting this particular orbit because there is no population on the North Pole and South Pole. For only research purpose, that orbit is initiated and some satellites are orbiting over that particular polar region. Most of these satellites are orbiting on the equatorial plane and some inclined plane, inclined angle of 5, 10, 20 or 30 degrees. Then two more orbits, which depend on the, based on the rotation of the rotation of the orbit as well as inclination angle of the orbit. If inclination angle of any orbit is lie between 0 to 90 degrees, that means this way, like this. This way. And along with this, if that orbit or that satellite is rotating along with the rotation of Earth, then that orbit is known as the prograde orbit. Means inclination angle between 0 to 90, inclination angle between 0 to 90 degree and the rotation is just similar to rotation of the Earth. If Earth rotation is clockwise, then satellite rotation or orbit rotation that will be also clockwise. Then that will be prograde. And if any satellite is just opposite to that one, that means rotation of satellite is just opposite to rotation of Earth. For example, suppose Earth is rotating clockwise and our satellite is rotating anti-clockwise and that inclination angle of that satellite is between 90 degree to 180 degree, then orbit is known as the retrograde orbit. But in most of the cases, we prefer this prograde orbit because we already know that if we throw any stone, if we are running and throwing any stone to any direction, then that that velocity of that particular stone that will be higher, that will travel the longer distance. As well as we require very less force to throw that particular stone. Same way, if you are launching any satellite in the direction of Earth rotation, then that required very less thrust to lift off from the surface of the Earth. So if we launch any satellite in prograde orbit, then that required very less thrust, very less power, and easily we can launch any satellite. And if we launch any satellite in opposite to that one, means retrograde orbit, then we require additional force to accumulate that rotation of the Earth. That's why maximum orbits are prograde orbits. Now the satellite bands which are used in the satellite communication are, this satellite communication is basically occur in the microwave frequency band. In the early era of the satellite communication, that satellite communication was in the L band and S band. But right now, the most popular bands for satellite communication are C band, X band, Ku band, and the K band, where satellite communication actually occur. Other than this, all this L band, S band, C, X, Ku, K, and Ka band are useful for the satellite application, for satellite communication, for the different applications, just like a navigation in case of, for mining observation, finding the minings, we require less, lower frequency. In that particular case, L-band is useful, or L-band is suitable. And for the GPS communications or GPS services, we require around 1.57 gigahertz and 1.212 gigahertz. So for GPS services, we need L-band. For weather monitoring, we require C-band. For the broadcasting applications, basically we are using Ku-band. Means our television broadcasting is basically occur over the Ku-band. And some experimental analysis are going on and the Ka-band with very wide bandwidth. So all these bands are all these bands are belongs from the higher frequency, microwave frequency. So it provides a very large spectrum, better antenna directivity, because the directivity is the function of frequency. And when frequency larger directivity. But due to high frequency, some losses are also associated with this, like higher propagation losses are involved in the low higher frequencies, lower wavelength, and the more sophisticated network or more sophisticated components we need to design for the high frequency communication, a satellite communication. So the band, the transmission frequency between the transmitting station and the satellite is known as the uplink frequency, and the frequency which used between the satellite to receiving station, that is known as the downlink frequency. Means ground to satellite, that is the uplink, and satellite to ground, that is known as the downlink. And two separate frequency are used for uplink as well as downlink to prevent interference. Because if we are using same frequency, then there will be chances of the interference, electromagnetic interference between uplink and downlink. So we are using separate frequencies for uplink as well as downlink. And this is the network for the satellite communication. Basically, this is the uplink and downlink path. This is the uplink and downlink path. Now, uplink and downlink path depends on the type of services and the complete channel between A to B, B to A. This is known as the complete path. From A to B, this is known as the channel. And if you're talking about communication between these two points only, so this part is known as the circuit, means A to B, this complete path, this to this and this to this. And again, this point to back to point A, that is known as the circuit. And if satellite or if user is only capable to either transmit or receive, then that will be only channel. Now again, based on the services, simplex or duplex. Simplex means one-way communication. Duplex means two-way communication. Like broadcasting is the one-way communication. Broadcaster is only capable to transmit, and receiver is only capable to receive that particular channel. While point-to-point communication, like mobile communication, is the two-way communication or full duplex, where both the users are capable to transmit and receive. So satellite can provide one-way communication as well as two-way communication. Okay. Now the most popular bands which are using in the satellite communication are this C-band, Ku-band, and Ka-band. And the frequency band of C-band is lie around for downlink 3.7 to 4.2 gigahertz, and for uplink 5.925 to 6.425 gigahertz. For Ku-band, in case of the broadcasting, 11.7 gigahertz to 12.2 gigahertz, and 14 to 14.5 gigahertz for the uplink. And in case of the research applications, Ka band is between 17.7 gigahertz to 21.2 gigahertz, while uplink frequency is 27.5 gigahertz to 31 gigahertz. So as you can see that in this particular table, that downlink frequency is always lower than uplink frequency. In all the bands, uplink frequency is much higher than downlink frequency. And basically, these bands are known as, in general terms, these bands we write just 6 by 4 gigahertz band, 14 by 11 gigahertz band, and 27 by 17 gigahertz band. Now, as we see in last table, that the uplink frequency is higher than downlink frequency. Can we choose the lower frequency for uplink and higher frequency for downlink? Of course, we can choose. But there will be one problem. Basically, the criteria for selecting higher frequency for uplink and lower frequency for downlink is the carrier to noise ratio. Because we already aware, if you study about the wireless communication, then the received power in case of wireless communication is given by the phase transmission equation, or calculated through the phase transmission equation, where PR is the received power, PT is the transmitting power of transmitting antenna, GT is the antenna gain of the transmitter, GR is the receiving antenna gain, and this lambda by 4 pi R, this is the path loss during the transmission. Okay, basically path loss is the 4 pi R by lambda whole square. So you can see that for any kind of transmission, the PT will be constant. If you are transmitting or we are generating any signal, then the PR is basically depends on what? PT, GT, GR. While the distance will be constant because we cannot change the separation between satellite and earth station. Lambda, operating frequency, it depends on the frequency. So frequency we can choose. So lower frequency we choose for the downlink, higher frequency we choose for the uplink. So basically the PR is depend on these four parameters, PT, GR, GT, and lambda. Lambda means C by M. Okay. So if frequency is higher, then you can see that. If frequency is higher, then PR will be lower. If frequency is lower, then obviously wavelength will be high, and then PR will be high. So for higher frequency is F2. For higher frequency, it provides a lower signal strength, right? For the lower frequency, it provides higher received power strength. So based on that, if we choose the lower frequency in uplink direction, then there will be no problem. Sufficient amount of signal we can receive through the satellite. But on the down conversion, there is a problem. Over the satellites, we are having very small antenna. So satellite antenna is limited along with the transmitting gain as well as the transmitted power. So in case of downlink, we are having very limited PT and GT. So we cannot transmit very large amount of power through the satellite. So if you are transmitting low power, then received power will be obviously very low because P is lower, GT will be low, and received power will be low. As well as if you are using higher frequency, then again received power will be low. So this PT and GT is little bit compensated with the lower frequency. If you use lower frequency, then lower frequency will produce little bit higher power compared to the higher one. And during the transmission uplink frequency, we can use any value of transmitter PT and any value of or any size of antenna gain. As we know that gain of the antenna is directly proportional to size of the antenna. So on the earth station, we can increase the size of antenna. So for during the transmission uplink, we can increase the size of antenna, or as well as we can increase the transmitted power, because over the earth we are not having any space limitation or size limitation. But on the satellite, we are having the space limitation, weight limitation, as well as size limitation. So that's why uplink frequency is little higher compared to downlink frequency. Always for downlink frequency, that will be lower and uplink frequency will be higher. Now coming to the type of orbits which used in the satellite communication or satellite launch in the space. So basically orbits can be classified based on three criteria. One is the shape. Shape means structure of the orbit. Inclination means how much it inclined along with the equatorial orbit, and the distance between the surface of the Earth and satellite. Okay, so most popular classification is this one, distance. Most of the orbits are nomenclature based on the distance. So first, based on the shape, so the two possible shapes are possible for satellite orbiting or orbits, one circular and elliptical. So elliptical one is more preferable in case of satellite. And then based on the inclination, that means value of I. Based on inclination, two types of orbits are there, inclined orbit and equatorial orbit. Equatorial orbit means where I equals to zero, which is parallel to the equatorial orbit, like this first case. This is the equatorial orbit, where you can see that this is the equatorial plane and this is the orbital plane. And both are parallel to each other. So this orbit is just passes through the center of the Earth and orbiting around the Earth. So when inclination angle is zero, then that will be equatorial orbit. And two other cases, inclined and polar orbit. So when I equals to 90 degree, then that will be polar. And if I is lie between 0 to 90 degree, then that will be inclined. Okay. Now in the third one, based on the distance, we can classify orbits primarily three case, but in the recent era, one more orbit is introduced, which is known as the highly elliptical orbit, HEO. So initially, there was three type of orbits, GEO, MEO, and LEO. GEO means geostationary orbit or geosynchronous orbit. MEO is the medium Earth orbit, and LEO is the low Earth orbit, based on the distance from center of the Earth or surface of the Earth. So GEO is around 36,000 approximately. Exactly, if you consider circular orbit, then exactly this value is 35,786 kilometers from the surface of the Earth. And if you measure from the center of the Earth, then just add 6,678 kilometers to that value. So separately, we will study this or discuss the GEO, MEO, LEO, and HEO. And this is the orbit, GEO orbit. And this coverage area is basically known as the footprint of the satellite. Footprint of the satellite. Okay. Our coverage of the satellite. So when larger coverage, a larger footprint, that means larger coverage, smaller footprint, then that will be smaller coverage. And that coverage area is completely depend on the orbit. That means coverage area is completely depends on the distance of the satellite from the Earth. For example, just suppose we are having any torch and just find the projection on wall. Suppose we are here and find the projection on the wall. Then you will find that projection of that satellite is smaller. Our footprint of the satellite is, torch is smaller. But when you move away from the wall, then you will find that projection of that same torch that will be increases along with this particular distance. Jitna dur jayenge, utna hi projection aapka increase hoga, right? So when satellite is moving away from the surface of the Earth, then that projection, that means that footprint is increases, coverage in angle and coverage area is increases. That's why the coverage of GEO satellite is much larger than LEO satellites. But one problem is there. Along with distance, that light density or light intensity is decreased. Same way, satellite signal, electromagnetic signal intensities also decrease along with the distance. So on this satellite communication, means higher distance or higher height, that signal intensity is lower. So first, we discuss about the LEO. Low Earth orbit belongs to height of 150 kilometer to around 1500 kilometer from surface of the Earth. That means height of this kind of satellite is approximately 150 to maximum 1500 kilometer. And the radius of that orbit is very smaller. So obviously there will be velocity of this orbits will be higher compared to MEO and GEO satellites. So after every 15 to 20 minutes, we need to interchange the satellites. Means our antenna, receiving antenna, can be contact with that particular satellite for around 15 to 20 minutes only. After that satellite will be moving away from the coverage of our receiving or transmitting antenna. Means after every 10 to 15 minutes, we need to change our transmitting or receiving satellite. So continuous tracking is required in case of LEO satellite. Means continuously we need to track the satellites, we need to move the our radar or antennas to receive particular signals, and we need to rotate along with that satellite. If satellite is moving upward or downward, then Earth station antenna should also be moved along with that particular satellite, because maximum signal we only receive when satellite antenna beam and Earth station antenna beam both are in the same line, because micro signals are line of sight signal. Microwave propagation is the line of sight propagation, and maximum intensity only received in the line of sight. Okay, so after every 5 to 15 minutes, we need handoff. Handoff means we need to switch from one satellite to next satellite, second to third, third to fourth, and so on. In case of the LEO satellite, we need either directional antenna or omnidirectional antenna. If you want to avoid this tracking, then you require omnidirectional antenna, because omnidirectional antennas are capable to transmit power in all the directions in one particular plane. So in that particular condition, we do not require any tracking. But the receiving capability of omnidirectional antenna is a little bit lower compared to the directional antenna, because gain of that type of antennas are lower compared to the directional antennas. To provide the global coverage, at least we required 66 satellites for the global coverage using the LEO orbit. If you launch any satellite in LEO orbit, then at least minimum 66 satellites are required to provide coverage on the complete Earth. And the advantage of this LEO satellite is that the time delay, because height of the satellite is much lower compared to MEO and GEO orbit, that's why the propagation delay or round trip delay between Earth station to Earth station is lower compared to other two cases, and around 10 millisecond signal delay is in the LEO orbits. Next one is the MEO medium Earth orbit. So this category is lie between LEO and GEO. And the height of this medium Earth orbit is around 5,000 kilometer to 12,000 kilometer from surface of the Earth. And this orbit is useful in the GPS communication, means our navigation communications. And because this height is between LEO and MEO, so obviously propagation delay is lie between that two conditions. So propagation delay in case of MEO is larger than LEO, but lower than GEO. This satellite is also require the tracking, but that tracking is little slower compared to the MEO. And around 20 satellites are sufficient to provide global coverage if satellite is in the MEO. Then the most important one is the GEO, because this GEO is the orbit which provide our broadcasting service. In both previous cases, we just said that we require antenna tracking, a satellite tracking. We need to find out where is our satellite and trace that particular satellite. But in case of geosynchronous orbit, we do not require any kind of tracking, because the orbital time period of geosynchronous orbit and the orbital time period of Earth, both are synchronized, means both are similar. The time period of geosynchronous orbit is similar to Earth orbital time period, that means 23 hours, 56 minutes and 4 seconds, which is known as the one real side day. But roughly we are saying that 24 hours. Due to this, only this difference, 4-minute difference, we are having one extra day after every 4 years. Right? So the exact orbital time period of Earth and that satellite are 23 hours, 56 minutes and 4 seconds. So that's why there is a no respective motion between geosynchronous satellite and the geosynchronous satellite and Earth station. So we do not require any tracking to track that particular satellite. Once we just install our antenna towards that particular satellite, then always continuously the two antennas will be moving in the same projection. So continuously Earth station antenna will face the satellite antenna, and satellite antenna will communicate towards the Earth antenna. So Earth rotate along with the same speed as the satellite, and the height of this orbit is 35,786 kilometer from surface of the Earth. And if you calculate, because most of the calculations we are doing from center of the Earth, so total distance that will be 35,786 kilometer plus radius of the Earth, 6,378 kilometer. So that is the height of geosynchronous orbit. And only three satellites. Okay. If you are using two satellites, then it also provides the global coverage. But some of the part, due to curvature of the Earth, some of the portion will skip. So at least three satellites are required to provide global coverage. While in case of the MEO, minimum 20 satellites are required. In case of LEO, at least 66 satellites are required. But in case of GEO, only 3 satellites are sufficient to provide global coverage, and which are installed over the 120 degree of separation. One satellite here, and one here. So that will provide the complete global coverage. One of the biggest disadvantages of this GEO is the 260 or 250 millisecond of delay, round trip delay. So there will be communication delay between transmitting station and receiving station. If you are transmitting any live data from one point to another point, then there will be delay of 260 millisecond. And doesn't matter that points are belong to same city or different city, because that distance, slant distance, will be almost similar. If you are transmitting one data from Patna to another point of Patna, then that distance will be similar, 35,000 up and 35,000 down. If you are transmitting from Patna to Delhi, then distance will be almost similar, very little difference, up to around 35,000 upward and 35,000 downward. So there will be delay of 260 millisecond between transmitter and receiving stations. Another category is the HEO, which is known as the highly elliptical orbit. So distance of this orbit, this is the highly elliptical, and the distance of satellite in this orbit is just approximately equivalent to GEO orbit, but the inclination angle is very higher, around 63 degree inclination angle is in the HEO. And this orbit is very useful for the polar data analysis. Means for the North Pole communication, South Pole communication, this type of orbit is useful. So with the help of HEO, we can provide the communication on the Northern Hemisphere and Southern Hemisphere. And example of this type of orbits are Molniya orbit and the Tundra orbit. So these orbits are just for the polar data analysis, polar research analysis. And the propagation delay is lie between 10 to 260 milliseconds. It depends where you are. That means, just like in this case, suppose receiving a transmitting station is here, just near to the perigee, then transmission delay will be lower. If Earth station is at this point, towards the perigee point, and satellite is at the apogee point, then transmission delay will be high. Okay? So, in this case, if you want to analyze on the Northern Hemisphere, then that orbital design is such that that apogee point towards the northern side. The reason behind this, at the apogee, velocity of satellite is very smaller. At the apogee point, satellite is moving with very low speed. And at the perigee point, the satellite is moving with a very high speed. So, now next one is the geostationary orbit. Geostationary orbit is the special type of the geosynchronous orbit, or you can say that it is the type of geosynchronous satellite. So geostationary orbit is the orbit which having the circular shape as well as the inclination angle of 0 degree. So basically geostationary orbit is the parallel orbit to equatorial plane, where inclination angle I is 0 and parallel to equatorial plane. Okay, so this is the unique case of geosynchronous one. And circular orbit is used in case of the geostationary orbit. The satellite direction rotation is similar to the Earth rotation, as you can see that in this particular GIF file. Satellite, that means this respective position of Earth station and satellite is always same. And the rotational speed of satellite and Earth is similar. Okay, so there is no respective motion between the satellite and Earth, and distance of this orbit is 3576 kilometers from surface of the Earth. The advantage of this type of satellite or this type of orbit is that satellite remain stationary with respect to the observer. Observer means either transmitter or receiver. So we do not require any costly tracking equipment. Or we we are not losing the signal strength from the satellite because both the beams are continuously towards the each other. So maximum power we are receiving as well as tracking requirement is completely eliminated. And due to this height, only 3 satellites are sufficient for the global coverage. So at any point of the Earth, we can provide global coverage. This part is not. Next one is due to the large coverage area, many of the Earth stations can be interconnected with the satellite because higher distance, higher footprint, coverage area will be also large. And the Doppler shift is nearly zero because there is a no respective motion between satellite and Earth station. So there will be no problem of any Doppler shift. Now there are some disadvantages of this type of orbit is it does not offer the coverage over the higher latitude areas because this is parallel to equatorial plane. So it's continuously rotating on the equatorial orbit in satellite 1, 2, and 3. So this continuously orbiting over the equatorial plane, the coverage area will be this way. But due to the curvature of the Earth, this region and this region will escape from the coverage of satellite. So latitude higher than 80 degree north or 80 degree south that cannot be covered through the geostationary satellite. For this type of coverage, we required polar satellite like HU. Okay. And the another disadvantage, due to the distance, there is a large propagation delay. And with the incremental altitude, the effect of eclipse become pronounced. Due to the higher distance, higher height, the eclipse effect is also higher in case of GEO or geostationary orbit. That eclipse effect we will discuss later on. The Earth station needs the highly sensitive low noise amplifiers or low noise front end amplifiers to receive the signals because distance is inversely proportional to the power is inversely proportional to the distance. So higher distance, that means lower signal strength. So we require highly sensitive receiver. Otherwise, we will not be able to recover the signal. We are not able to recover the transmitted signal. Next type of satellite, not on the height or inclination. This one is basically sun synchronous orbit. Because we know that the primary source of satellite operation is the solar cells, a solar energy. Primary signal we receive from the solar energy, we receive from the solar panels. So complete operation, that means health management of satellite as well as transmission of satellite, that power is coming from the sun. So some satellites are designed such a way where you always focus towards the, where solar cells are always focused towards the Earth. And as we know that Earth is rotated in around the sun as well as it also rotated over the its own axis. So the orbital motion of satellite is Earth is 360 degree as well as axial rotation of Earth is around 23 degree. That means over the complete year, position of sun is moving just like a sinusoidal motion. For 6 months between summer to winter and winter to again summer, the sun is moving from northern hemisphere. For next 6 months is moving from southern hemisphere, and this variation is maximum around 23.4 degree. So that due to this motion, that direction of sun is changing along with this motion of sun position. So we need to also rotate the solar panels, solar cells towards the sun. So in case of sun synchronous orbit, scientists are just selecting two different orbits. One where the satellite is moving in between 0 to 90 degree inclination angle, and another orbit where satellite is moving in between 90 to 180 degree orbit. That means for 6 months, it's moving from north to south, both the cases, but for 6 months, was the north side for 6 months, for 6 months from towards the northern hemisphere, and for the rest of the 6 months through the southern hemisphere, so that it can receive maximum power and it can utilize the maximum power for the transmission. And this type of high power transmission is required for the highly sensitive applications, just like military applications and remote sensing applications, where we required very large intensity signal, and we should transmit that signal so that it can penetrate the surface, or that can be received by in any environmental condition or any conditions. And example of this type of satellites are the Landsat and the QuickBird, and useful in the military and remote sensing applications. Another one is the Molniya orbit, which we already discussed, in the highly elliptical orbit. It's a highly inclined orbit, and the orbital time period of this orbit is around 12 hours. Now, as a RF engineer or as a satellite designer, some design aspects of satellite communication, if you want to design any satellite, then some points we need to take care of. Like that launching cost is directly depend on the size of the satellite or weight of the satellite. If weight is higher, then cost launching cost will be higher. So first objective, the size should be small as well as weight should be low. In the second generation satellite, that weight is around 1100 to 1300 pound. Satellite weight, general application or broadcasting application satellite weight is around 1100 to 1300 pound. And the next objective is large number of communication channel capability. How we can accommodate maximum number of users without interference. And we can use many techniques like FDMA, TDMA. By using this type of techniques, we can accommodate maximum number of users by reducing or minimizing error or noises or interferences. Next object, suppose as a service provider, if I want to purchase any spectrum, I want to purchase any satellite, then first question is what? Just like we are purchasing any equipment or any mobile or laptop, first we ask what is the lifetime or what is the warranty of this equipment, right? Because we need to know that what will be the at least average life of this particular device. The same way, if you are purchasing or if you are broadcaster, then first interest is lifetime of satellite. Based on that, we can expend our money. So lifetime is also important without maintenance, because once we launch any satellite, we cannot maintain or we cannot repair any module. So lifetime is also important without any maintenance. So generally, lifetime of GEO satellites is approximately 10 to 15 years. And the flexibility to accommodate new trends, because once, suppose we today launch one satellite, and after 2 years, 2 years later, some new services coming, a new service is launched, so that our satellite should be able to accommodate that service also. Otherwise, that satellite will not be in the or useful manner. So that flexibility should be available along with the satellite. That means provision of new services that should be also in the satellite, and the ground station antennas. During the designing, the ground station antenna, we can increase the any size, any gain. So ground station antenna should be large. Earth station satellite antenna should be smaller with the higher gain. And designing of that antenna should be such a way that can provide the narrow beam as well as higher directivity and gain. And also careful attention towards the antenna gain, signal to noise ratio, because we are always dealing with very low signal to noise ratio. So our primary attention is that we should transmit at least minimum required signal to noise ratio, so that that can be easily received by any receiving module. And another is the modulation is also important. Which type of modulation is suitable for the communication? Like in case of the satellite communication, mostly FM modulation is preferable for the analog one, and the PM modulation for the digital data. Encoding scheme is also important for the RF engineer. So these aspects are important for the designing any satellite. as well as during the satellite launching, there are many different type of testing is performed over the satellite, like electrical testings for analyzing the electrical stability, and the thermal testing, vibrational testing, and the temperature behavior, how it behaves along with the temperature, because at that particular height, the temperature variation is very higher. As well as that vibration testing is also performed, because on the space, there are lots of debris and garbage data, garbage. Like suppose we are launching any satellite, and after their lifetime, that will be just inactive. So that inactive satellite will be continuously moving in the space. So that moving satellites, garbage satellites, known as the debris, that can also be collide with the satellite, a strike with the satellite, so that physical structures should be capable to bear that particular vibration or collision. So vibrational or physical experiments are also performed on the body of the satellite. So physical vibrational testing, temperature testing, and electrical testing is performed on the satellite over the Earth station for the critical conditions. Next, the planetary motion of the satellite is the planetary motion of the satellite is given by the are explained by the Kepler's law. So Kepler given the three planetary laws for the planet motion. First law says that the orbit is the elliptical orbit where the larger object or Earth is centered over the one of the focus of the orbit. Suppose this is the elliptical orbit, then this Earth will be situated on the either this focus or this focus. Okay, and when it's situated on the one of the focus, then obviously there will be one point is near, another point will be farther. So this near point will be perigee, and this will be apogee point. Next law, he says that related to the area covered by the satellite. That means for the equal time interval, satellite sweeps out the equal area in the orbital plane. That means when satellite is moving through the apogee point, then velocity will be low. And when it's moving at the perigee point, then velocity will be higher. So that at this point, the satellite is moving with very high speed so that it can trace this much area. And at the apogee point, it's moving with a very low velocity. The tracing area will be this much. But the total density of this area, or total area covered by this satellite during the similar hours or similar time interval, that will be same. That means area A1 covered during 1 hour and area A2 covered during 1 hour, that will be same. Means at the apogee point, velocity is lower, and at the perigee point, velocity will be high. Okay, and this is due to the Kepler's law. This is due to the planetary motion of the satellite. In terms of mathematical expression, we'll see on the next slide. Third law is associated with the time period of the planet, a time period of the satellite. Third law said that the square of time period of orbit is proportional to the cube of mean distance between the two bodies. That means T square is directly proportional to the distance between center of the Earth to the planet, or center of the Earth to the satellite. So T cube is proportional to T square is proportional to the A cube, or T square is equivalent to the equivalent to the 4 pi square by mu, which is the proportionality constant, and into A cube, where mu is the Kepler's constant. And in term of the radius of the Earth, we can write A equals to mu by 4 pi square to the power 1 by 3 into T to the power 2 by 3. Now, next question arises, how satellite rotate in the orbit? So, explanation of this question is that on the orbit, if any object moving in their trajectory, then there will be two forces for acting on that particular body. So, based on the Newton's two law, one law says that the force acting on the body is equal to product of mass and acceleration, that means F equals to ma, which is also known as the centrifugal force, which gives F equals to mv square by r. And another law of Newton is the gravitational law. As per the gravitational law, the force acting between the two bodies or two masses that means mass of the satellite and mass of the Earth, is proportional to the masses of the larger body and smaller body, and inversely proportional to the square of that particular distance. So, as per the gravitational law, F is equivalent to Gm, and capital M is the mass of Earth, which is around 5.98 into 10 to the power 24 kg, and small m is the mass of satellite, and that G is the proportionality constant or gravitational constant, which is around 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11 Newton meter square per kg square. So, if any object moving with any particular speed where these two forces are equivalent, then your satellite will be moving, continuously moving in this particular orbit. Okay. And the orbital velocity can be achieved by the when we equate these two forces, centripetal force and centrifugal force, then we will find that velocity is proportional to or equivalent to square root of g into mass of Earth divided by divided by r, where g into m is also known as the Kepler's constant. So you can again write v equals to square root of mu by r, where mu is the Kepler constant and r is the separation between center of the Earth to satellite. So with the help of this formula, we can calculate the velocity of the satellite. So as I told you in the Kepler's law, when distance is lower, when distance is shorter, then obviously velocity will be what? Higher. When distance will be large, that means at the apogee point, then velocity will be low, right? Next, the solar eclipse, that is the effect of the solar eclipse. As we know that the primary source of the satellite communication, the solar energy, but sometimes the solar eclipse reduces that intensity of sun or just completely block the sun coverage towards the satellite. That means solar eclipses are basically two types. One, when Earth is coming between the path of sun and Earth comes between the satellite and sun. So that will be known as the eclipse due to the Earth. And some another situation is when moon is coming between the satellite and the sun, then energy is just blocked by the either Earth or moon. So these two conditions can be occur during the satellite motion. So that is known as the solar eclipse. We are not going into detail because time is very good. Let's put time is left. So due to that orbital motion of the sun, there is a fluctuation of 23.4 degree. So maximum that solar eclipse occur duration is given by a maximum area, a maximum curve, shadow area, shadow angle of this eclipse is given by this particular expression. Like this is the condition, this is sun coming from the infinite distance. So any light coming from the infinite distance, then that projection of that light that will be uniform and passing through any object, then that shadow of that object will be in cylindrical form. So suppose this is the Earth and here is our satellite. So that shadow region will be this way. This much will be the shadow region. And this shadow region at the shadow angle is given by this formula, 180 degree into minus 2 cos inverse of Re by R0, where R is the radius of Earth and R0 is the distance of satellite from center of the Earth. So with the help of this, we can find the total shadow area, a shadow region for the eclipse, or shadow region due to the eclipse. And the maximum time to cover that shadow region is approximately 69 minutes. So maximum shadow due to Earth eclipse, that will be 69 minutes, and that condition occur when we are at the on autumn or spring equinox. Means when we are at the time where equinox is coming, and on that same time solar eclipse occur, then maximum shadow duration or shadow time, that will be 69 minutes. That means we require at least 70 minutes backup plan for the transmission. That's why we also use the secondary sources for the transmission. So secondary dry sources, dry batteries are also transmitted or launched along with the satellite, are included in the satellite for the this type of emergency services or solar eclipse services. Next is the sun transit outage. This is also a phenomena which we all face during the transmission. Sometimes you receive this type of signal on your DTH. That means due to the sun transient outage, we are not able to transmit any signal. So basically, this sun transient outage is what? Sun is the biggest source of energy, as well as sun is the largest source of the noises. So sun energy is much, much higher than compared to the transmitted power of the satellite. So if beam of the sun and beam of the satellite antenna is coming in the same path, and that condition is known as a sun transient outage. In that particular condition, our receiving antenna cannot receive much power from the sun. From the satellite, and that sun energy is dominating over the satellite energy. That's why we cannot receive satellite signal, and we cannot do with this condition. We just need to wait and watch. So for around 0.02% of time over the year, this type of condition occur approximately one or two times over the year. This condition occur. So we just wait for this particular time. We just wait that sun satellite just move away from that particular beam, and we should receive the signals. Now the orbital inclination, we already discussed about that. Inclined orbits are highly inclined orbit. Now the station keeping is basically the monitoring process of the satellite, where we just monitor the orbital position of satellite, because due to the gravitational force of moon, sun, or any other planets, that position of our satellite is fluctuated or deviated from its original path. And as well as due to the non-linear surface structure of Earth, at some point that hilly kind of presentation, sometimes flat surface, and not exactly circular plane area, that non-linear gravitational force is also produced by the Earth. So due to that non-uniform gravitational force of Earth also, that satellite is moving from its actual position. Suppose this is the actual position, and due to this gravitational forces, it can be displaced or deviate from its original path. It may be in term of latitude or longitude, maybe moving in term of height, or maybe move in term of the horizontal displacement. So that latitude and longitude displacement can be controlled or monitored by the TTCM, telemetry tracking command station, because purpose of that Earth station is just monitor the health and observing the position of the satellite. So if TTCM or observatory control station, if observe any kind of fluctuation in a deviation in the position, then it's apply two type of techniques, which is known as the north-south station keeping and east-west station keeping. North-south station keeping is basically useful to prevent the latitude variation. That means if satellite is moving in term of height or moving in term of the latitude, then north-south station keeping is useful. And if satellite is moving in term of horizontal position, this longitude position, then east-west station keeping is useful. Basically, this station keeping is what? In this case, if latitude or longitude fluctuation is occur, then we just apply some additional force, additional thrust in this particular direction, either north-south direction or east-west direction, to control latitude and longitude position. Now, the how much amount of signal, how much amount of drift possible in latitude and longitude? So, in case of latitude, the maximum drift or maximum deviation is equivalent to I. Suppose this is the orbital plane. Sorry, this is the equatorial plane, and this red one is the orbital plane. Orbital plane. So inclination angle between equatorial plane and the orbital plane is just I. Then the maximum latitude shifting and maximum drift is this much. The satellite can be shifted up to this value. Same deviation in the upper side. Okay. So maximum deviation for the satellite in drift in the latitude is given by I. And in term of displacement, that means this angular deviation, angular separation, that can be multiplied with the radius of orbit. So maximum displacement given by R naught into lambda max, that means R naught into I. In term of the longitude, In terms of longitude, basically this is the empirical formula, which is based on the experimental analysis. So this empirical formula is given up to I is less than equals to 5 degree, not more than, because most of the satellites are between this region, inclination angle of 5 degree. Because on the very high latitude, we are not having any population. So most of the services are not offered on the South Pole and North Pole. So maximum satellites are moving in between I 0 to 5 degree. So longitude variation is given by, maximum drift is given by I square by 228, and the displacement is that R naught into psi max is d lambda into I by 228. So from these two expressions, you can see that the latitude drift is much, much higher than longitude drift. Means latitude drift is dominating over the longitude drift. So impact of latitude drift is higher compared to the longitude drift. So now next is the how to control this drift. That drift can be controlled by station keeping. Station keeping means applying some force, some thrust just opposite to the drift. Like suppose if satellite is moving in this direction, so we will apply some thrust so that the satellite can move away from this direction to again its original direction. And that required thrust or required impulse is given by delta V, this is the required impulse, is equivalent to square root of mu, its Kepler's constant, divided by A, radius of the orbit, to tan I, where I is the inclination angle. And A is nothing but R naught, its radius of the orbit. So this much amount of thrust in meter per second is applied to this satellite. So along with every satellite, there are multiple number of thrusters are installed in the different direction, different axial directions, so that we can control the drifting in latitude, longitude as per their displacement. Next is the launching process. A satellite launch vehicles, a satellite launching, how satellites are launched to the free space. Basically, two type of launching vehicles are useful in satellite communications. One type of space is known as the reusable launch vehicle, like a space shuttle. A space shuttle, just like an aeroplane, taking people from one point to another point, then coming back, and then taking people from one point to another point. Same way, the space shuttle is reusable. Just taking any satellite, going to their orbit, placing that particular satellite, and coming back to their launching station. And that can be used for the another mission. And next one is the expendable launch vehicles. Expendable launch vehicle, especially for the large distance propagation, or large distance transmission, large distance launching of the satellite. If we need to launch any satellite in the apogee point, then we need expendable launch vehicles. And for the short distance, like LEO or MEO, and if you are launching any satellite on the perigee point, so perigee point is obviously the nearest point from the Earth. So for the perigee launching, that reusable launch vehicles are useful, space shuttle is useful. But if you want on the apogee point, so in that particular case, expendable launch vehicle is useful. This picture is taken from the NASA, ISRO website. This is the picture of our expendable vehicles. Now, these are the three more pictures of India's expendable launch vehicles. Expendable launch vehicle, first one is the PSLV, Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, model is 335. Next one is GSLV D6. GSLV is geosynchronous launching vehicle, satellite launching vehicle. And the latest one is the GSLV Mk2 and Mk3. That last picture is the GSLV Mk3, Mk3. Where this GSLV Mk3 is the very high weight, as well as having very high thrust launching vehicle. It is capable to lift very high amount of weight. And some comparison, this Indian launching vehicles are this way, like SLV, ASLV, and PSLV and GSLV and the GSLV MK2 and MK3. So you can see that the capability of all the satellite increases along with the time or evolution of the launching vehicles. Right now, India is capable to launch multiple number of satellite in the single launch, or it's capable to place multiple number of satellites in space through the launching vehicles. So India is offering that launching facility to many other countries also. So the right now latest one is the MK3, which is having the capability of around 4,000 kg payload. Payload means the satellite basically. So it can be capable, it is capable to lift up the 640 ton of weight. So basically maximum weight is the launching vehicle weight, and the payload weight is around 4,000 kg. And the technique for this propulsion technique used in the MK3 is the solid liquid along with the cryogenic engine. We also heard about the cryogenic engine. That means this type of engine is having very large capability to lift up the high weight or produce the very high propulsion to carry any satellite, like in Chandrayaan and Mangalyaan, in both the cases that MK3 was used. Some more launching vehicle which was worldwide with the height and the countries, like V2 from the Germany, R7 of Russia, Saturn from US, Space Shuttle from US, Ariane of ESA, Delta 4 from the US, Proton from the Russia, and KZ2F from the China. This is the part of the launching vehicle, that multiple number of cells. These are the ignition cells. These cells are basically for the propulsion. These cells are providing, carrying the fuels, and that provide the thrust for the launching. That our useful part is this much only. This is the satellite. Rest of the part just for the launching purpose. So these are the multiple number of stages. In case of shuttle space, there is a one spacecraft only. But in case of expendable launch vehicle, there are multiple number of stages, and that are separated along with the distance or height. That means after certain height, these spaces or these stages are separated from the vehicle. Then weight of the vehicle will be reduces. Then this part will carry on the satellite to the higher height. Then this will be also detached, and at last satellite will be placed at the orbit. Thereafter, their solar panels are open and satellite is moving to their orbit. Now, how the satellites are launched to the free space, you can see in this picture as well as this animation, that in the initial stage, the satellite is launches from the launching station, then with a very high thrust is lift up from the surface. And after a certain height, these stages are separated from this launch vehicle, and that will be just separating and just drop to the predefined trajectory path, and then the rest of the module is just moving to the space. In the second stage, that this part, the clear part, is separated from the satellite. Then payload is moving along with the kick motor or kick rocket. Then kick rocket is moving up to the orbital plane. Suppose this is the orbital plane. So up to the orbital plane, that kick motor is moving through your satellite to orbital plane, and then at the orbital plane, then the kick motor is just pushing some force that to the particular payload so that it can be moved over the its predefined path. Till that, your satellite panel, solar panels are open. Now solar panels are open, then it taking the energy from sun, and now satellite is moving to the earth, its predefined trajectory. Next is the satellite stabilization. That means the type of the satellite. Basically, two type of structure are useful or used in case of designing of the satellite. One is the spin stabilized satellite, and another one is the body stabilized satellite. So, spin stabilized satellite structure is basically a cylindrical type of structure, as you can see that in this picture. That this is the cylindrical structure where solar panels are installed on the body of this cylinder. and the cylindrical structure is having a spinning platform as well as de-spooling platform. This lower part is the de-spooling platform where antennas are installed. So these antennas are continuously tracking the, continuously facing towards the Earth station, and this spinning platform is moving along with the around 60 to 100 RPM speed. And that spinning provides the minimizing the thermal temperature, thermal effect of the sun, because the solar panels are installed on the body. So due to the solar energy, the body temperature increases, but this continuous rotation reduces the body temperature. And it's efficient for the smaller satellite and LEO satellites, and antenna is on the peaceful platform. Another type is the three-axis stabilized satellite. This type of satellite is more popular compared to the spin stabilized satellite. In this case, either cylindrical or rectangular or square shape of satellite is having the solar panels which is connected along with this body, and that can be expanded away from the particular body. When solar panels are installed over the two plates, and that can be expanded, and that are having very large number of cells. So this type of satellites are receiving much and much energy from the solar cells, and it can be converted it up to around 2.2 kilowatt of, it can be capable to generate approximately 2.2 kilowatt of energy for the health monitoring, operation, satellite operation and communication. So this type of satellites are having three axes, which is known as the yaw axis, roll axis and pitch axis. Yaw axis, in the yaw axis, antennas are installed, and antennas are having some earth-seeking sensors. Due to that earth-seeking sensor, the antennas continuously monitor, continuously face toward the earth. And the pitch axis, along the pitch axis, two solar panels are installed, and that are continuously rotated along with the sun, this direction of the sun. That means the plates are continuously faced towards the sun. And another one is the roll axis, which is just parallel to a tangential to the orbital plane. And these are the three axes. This is the, this one is the roll axis. This one is the pitch axis, roll axis, and this towards the antenna. Now next is the mathematical analysis, or mathematical analysis, the propagation of signal. So we are directly going to power strength or carrier to noise ratio, because we are always dealing with the very low carrier to noise. So how much amount of signal we are receiving, we can transmit or receive through this antenna, satellites, that can be explained by this expression. So received power can be calculated from the phase transmission equation, as we already seen earlier. So PR is directly depend on the transmitted power, transmitting antenna gain, receiving antenna gain, and the distance. This path loss. This factor is known as the path loss. Whenever the distance increases, path loss increases. When the wavelength is lower, smaller, path loss will be high. So this same expression can be write in term of the dB, because all the calculations in satellite communication we perform in terms of the dB, gain of the antennas are also given in the dB. So that can also be represented in terms of the dB. So PR is equal to EIRP. Basically that EIRP is a factor. EIRP, that means effective isotropic radiated power. That means how much amount of power effectively transmitted towards the antenna. So any signal is transmit generating, any transmitter is generating, or any power amplifier is generating any power PT. But practical antennas are not isotropic antennas. Practical antennas are the directional antennas. So that power is just carrying in one particular direction. That's why the power is transmitted along with, multiplied with the direction, GT. So the combination of this PT and GT is known as the effective isotropic radiated power. In GR and dB, then path loss, that means 4 pi r by 20 lambda. So in dB, you can write 20 log of 4 pi r by lambda. Other than this, some more factors are included in this expression. These factors are basically attenuations or losses. This is the loss due to the atmospheric condition, because atmospheric conditions are changes between transmitting station and satellite, or receiving station and satellite. So that atmospheric conditions are also producing some attenuation or losses. So that reduces the signal strength. Along with this, antenna tracking losses on transmitter and antenna tracking losses in the receiver. That means, suppose there is a little bit motion, a little bit variation in the beam in transmitting antenna and receiving antenna, or antenna is not capable. In case of GEO, there is a no tracking losses. But in case of other LEO and MEO, suppose transmitting antennas are not exactly tracking our satellite, then there will be loss because beam width is such a. When your satellite beam width and antenna beam width both are in the same direction, then we will get maximum power. But if our receiving antenna beam width in this way, then there will be loss in the received power because we are not in the maximum power direction. The next, during the uplink and transmission, uplink and downlink, the total carrier to noise power is represented by this expression, because during the transmission, some noise is added due to solar energy and other interfering signals. So that total power, a total signal to noise power at satellite during uplink is given by this factor, PTGT by L. L is again antenna tracking losses and atmospheric losses. Into 4 pi FUDU, we just change this factor to in this term, in terms of speed and velocity and frequency. So this is the 4 pi FUDU divided by C. So one factor is good. This will be square. 4 pi FUDU by C square into GU by TU into 1 by KB, where this KTB is the noise power and is given by KTB. The K is the Boltzmann's constant, B is the noise bandwidth, and T is the noise temperature. When the noise temperature or temperature of any satellite is higher than zero, a physical temperature, a zero Kelvin, then that device will produce some noise. So if noise is higher, then that will produce thermal noise or thermal temperature. And then the thermal temperature produces thermal noise. So maximum noise due to the thermal temperature is, that's why that noise power we just consider KTB. So we just divide the carrier power, that means this PR, with this KTB. So our expression will be this one. Same expression for the downlink. In case of downlink, that land distance will be different, frequency will be different. Here is a DU, FU, FD, and AD. And this G and T. GU and TU is the antenna gain of satellite. And TU is the noise temperature during uplink. But this G and T is the antenna gain of receiving antenna and temperature of the receiving devices. Okay, so this G by T is also very important, because based on this G by T ratio, the G by T ratio is also known as the figure of merit. Okay, this G by T ratio is just defined or explain the quality of Earth station. When G by T for any Earth station is higher, then we can say that this Earth station is very good. If G by T ratio is lower, then we say that the quality of this Earth station is poor, because PR is directly depend on the G by T. When G by T is high, then PR, I mean, carrier to noise ratio will be higher. G by T ratio will be low, then carrier to noise ratio will be low. So for intersat organization, that G by T ratio is approximately 46 dB per Kelvin. Means at least this much amount of G by T ratio is required for intersat organization. And if higher than this, that will be better. Then the combined impact of uplink and downlink is explained by this factor. That means C by N, total C by N is equivalent to C by N uplink inverse plus C by N downlink inverse and then pole inverse. That means if you want to calculate the total carrier to noise ratio, then just calculate separately uplink C by N, separately downlink C by N, and combine this two. Then you will find a total C by N ratio with the help of this link design formula. Okay. And suppose we are having an intermodulation, interference from other sources, or interchannel intermodulation, interchannel interferences, then one more factor is added along with this, will be C by I. That is carrier to interference ratio, C by I inverse to the whole inverse. Right? Because that interference reduces the signal strength. So we also add this Now the last topic is the satellite components. Satellite components means equipment which are used in the satellite communication. Are basically there are two type of components, or two categories. One is the satellite component, another one is the earth station component. So in case of satellite component, basically satellite components are what? It is the transreceiving channel. So transreceiving channel is having what? One receiver, amplifiers, filters, mixers, and then again amplifiers and another antenna. So basic block diagram for satellite component is what? This is the antenna which receives the uplink signal, and that uplink signal passes through the low noise amplifier, and that low noise amplifier is nothing but just say one bandpass filter and amplifier. Then this passes through the mixer, because uplink frequency is first down converted to downlink one, lower frequency, and then that will be passes through the particular band, again amplify and retransmit. So this is the nature of satellite, because satellite is just repeater. It's receive, amplify, retransmit. So that receiver or repeaters are also two type. One is a transparent transponder. That repeaters are that communication link is known as the transponder. So these are the two type. One is the transparent, another one is a regenerator. Transparent transponder, check up the block diagram. Just like transparent transponders are just receiving your signal, amplify that particular signal and retransmit. They are not doing any onboard processing. Means they just received uplink signal, passes through the amplifier, just amplify, then down converted. For example, 6 and 4 gigahertz band, they received on the 6 gigahertz, down converted to 4 gigahertz, amplify, and then retransmitted. Okay, but in case of regenerative, in first one, what? In case of the first one, this repeater, this transponder amplify the complete signal. Massive signal as well as noisy signal also. Noise also. That means they doesn't care about the noise or interference or any error or anything. They just receive whatever they receive on that particular frequency, amplify and retransmit. So quality of this type of signal is little poor compared to regenerative transponder type of signals. In case of regenerative transponders, they are having onboard capability, that means onboard processing capability. So in case of regenerative transponder, signals are received, then down converted. After down converted, they are demodulating the signal. After demodulation, they are performing the error correction, a noise removal technique, applying the noise removal technique and error correction techniques. And after that, they are again modulating that signal on 4 gigahertz, this downlink frequency, and then amplify and retransmit. So in this case, this regenerative repeater eliminate the error as well as minimize the noise. So signal quality or signal to noise ratio of this type of signal is much better than transparent transponders. And transponders are having approximately 500 megahertz of band for 6 by 4 gigahertz satellites, 14 by 11 gigahertz satellites, and approximately 2.5 gigahertz for 27 by 18 and 17 gigahertz satellite. So these bands are commercially available. This band is right now just for the experimental purpose. So 500 megahertz is the bandwidth of total transponders. Now that bandwidth is divided in separate 24 transponders. So that means 24 different channels, and then that 24 channels are again divided in multiple number of user channels. Okay, so one transponder of 24 megahertz is capable to transmit around 5 television HD channels and 1 to 2 HD channels. Because HD channels having large information, large bandwidth, that's why only 1 to 2 HD channels can be transmitted through one transponder. While HD channels are having less information, less bandwidth required. That's why 5 to 6 HD channels can be transmitted through one transponder. So one satellite can be capable to transmit around 100 HD channels at a time. Next one is the Earth station component. So on the Earth station, we are having transmitting and receiving module. So some part in the indoor module, some part is the outdoor module. So it's like this is a signal path for transmitting module. This is the for transmitting module. This is our receiving module. So any of these antenna is capable to transmit and receive either on the same frequency or different frequency. So signal is transmitted in this way. This is the simple process of modulation and transmission. That means information is first modulated and then up converted to the desired frequency, and that will be passes through the high power amplifier, solid state power amplifiers, and then through the filter connected with antenna and transmitted to satellite. During the reception, that down converted signal is received by the antenna, passes through the filter, and that filter is passes to LNA, low noise amplifier, and then that LNA will pass to the block down converter, because this frequency is very high. It either is 4 gigahertz or 11 gigahertz, but our carry frequency is lower. So we first down convert this lower frequency with respect to the terrestrial network frequency, 70 megahertz or 80 megahertz. And thereafter, we demodulate that particular frequency to our original information necessary. That means this is the trust receiving process of the satellite. These are the few sources of this lecture. And thank you for listening to this lecture. Any query related to?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Ritesh sir. So we would like to start a questionnaire session. Actually, I would like to tell you, sir, that we are having more than 200 students listening to us on YouTube and Facebook. So they have posted few questions, sir. So may I put the question before you, sir?
Okay.
Yes, sir. First question is what is the role of OMNET in satellite communication?
What OMNET,
sir?
OMNET means, actually I didn't heard this term.
Okay. So, sir, second question one student has asked, is there any future scope for the repairment of satellite after they launched?
No. That kind, till now, that type of facility is not available. That type of research is not done. But it may be in future, it may be possible when satellite or people are moving to the moon or space, then there will be facility, because we are having facility to changing the orbit. So we can change the orbit of any satellite through the ground station. So ground station can control the orbital motion of satellite, orbit of the satellite. So we can change that orbit of satellite to our space station, towards the space station. And on the space station, that can be possible. But that is very tedious and not right now, this is not possible. But in future, it may be possible. That's why during the design of satellite, the redundancy path are also provided along with the communication channels. In many of the parts, like a mixers, in maximum communication channels, most of the time mixer means resistors or capacitors or diodes are having maximum possibility of failure. So redundancy path is always available with every channel. So suppose if any device is not working, then through the TTCM control station, that command is passed to switch on the next channel. So our communication is just, suppose this is the one channel where communication will occur. Now due to any reason, suppose this one is failed, then this communication channel switch to the redundancy path, and that continuous communication will be continued, right? So if any device fail, then that will be, we are having alternative path, alternative option.
One more question is there. What is the main challenges satellite faces in C-band?
In C-band, basically C-band.
Yes.
In case of C-band, C-band is lie between 4 to 8 gigahertz. Okay. So in case of C-band, basically C-band is having very large bandwidth frequency, bandwidth efficiency. In C-band, we are having around 500 megahertz bandwidth. But in case of C-band, we are having lower frequency. The C-band is having a little lower compared to this Ku-band as well as K-band. So as we know that speed of communication is directly proportional to the operating frequency, or speed of communication directly proportional to the operating frequency. So speed in 4 to 8 gigahertz, little bit lower. As well as you already know that between the 4 to 8 gigahertz, very large amount of very high terrestrial applications belongs, like our WLAN application, our Wi-Fi yes. application belongs to this particular category. So interference chances are maximum in this particular band. So we need to avoid that interference by either increasing the power, transmitted power of a satellite, or we need to increase the efficiency of filters. That means practical filters cannot provide a steep response. That will be just gracefully down like that. So we need to improve the response of this filter so that it can provide a selective band so that we should reduce the interference. And at 4 gigahertz, especially that 4 gigahertz is the microwave frequency band. So at this high frequency, designing of mixers and that dividers and couplers and all, these are very tedious. So design complexity is also involved along with the high frequency or micro frequency communications. And the beam width is a little bit wider in 4 to 8 gigahertz compared to the 18 gigahertz. That's why a little bit scattering, a little bit padding is little higher compared to the higher frequency communication. Padding means, suppose this is a transmitter and receiver. So in case of microwave communication, we know that signal is transmitted in line of sight. So based on microwave itself reduces the padding, but on the low frequency, that padding is a little bit higher than higher frequency. But on the low frequency, beam width is wider. So this signal is also transmitted to other direction, and that will reflect yes. back to the receiver. Transmitted to any other direction, transmitted, reflected back from building and received to the receiver. So that signal combined on the receiver, if that signals are in phase, then that will produce the higher energy. But if that signal are an out of phase, then that will produce the lower signal strength. So that padding effect is larger in case of 4 to 8 gigahertz in compared to the 18 to
yes.
12 to 18 gigahertz or 26 to 40 gigahertz. So this band is better compared to the 4 to 8 gigahertz, but this Ku band is also having some disadvantage. I think you know that resonance of water particles, the resonance of water is around 12.4 and 16 gigahertz. So when your communication will occur on this resonance frequency, then there will be dispersive nature, that signal will be dispersed from their original path. Like in the rainy season, our DTS signal is just distorted because due to the water particle, that signal is coming from the satellite. And due to this water particle, that signal is scattered to the space. That's why in rainy or cloudy environment, we are not receiving signal. But that type of problem is not occurring in the 4 to 8 gigahertz. But the 4 to 8 gigahertz is also having one advantage over the higher frequency band. As we know that lower frequency, that means higher wavelength, is capable to penetrate larger distance. And higher frequency means lower wavelength is not capable to penetrate any body or any surface. Because along with the frequency, that depth of penetration is reduces, right? So low frequency 4 to 8 gigahertz band is having larger penetration depth, higher power compared to the Ku and other bands.
So I think student have got their answer on most of the question which the student is asking, sir. I think you have answered all the questions in your presentation. Like one student have asked why the uplink frequency is higher than the downlink frequency. You have already answered this question. Sir, one last question, I think, which is kind of new question is, what option are available or plan for a satellite communication system for disaster teams? So this is one kind of new question.
Disaster team, disaster in case of disaster management.
Yes.
So satellites are providing weather analysis and the navigation services for the disaster management. The satellite data is also used for the navigation as well as mining. Like with the help of mining, we can identify the object beneath the surface or any object. Mm-hmm. Inside the surface or inside the building that can be easily monitored. Just like a radar, we can transmit any signal through the satellite. That signal is reflected back through the any object or any body, and that can be reflected back to the satellite. Based on that processing of that data, we can monitor or we can identify the position of the user. Just like a GPS. With the help of GPS, we can find the position of any vehicle, any aircraft, any person, or any mobile location. So by using that GPS service or navigation service, we can find out that casualty in any area, disaster condition in any area, and weather forecasting for any particular area. So we should reduce the casualties and we should improve the plan for the disaster management.
Thank you, sir. So I think the presentation given by you, sir, was very enriched and was from very basic. Even I am from electrical engineering domain, and one of my colleagues is from mechanical engineering domain. We really enjoyed the presentation, and from very basic, we are understanding how the process is going on, how the satellite is uploading, and what are the features, what are the things which we have to take care while the communication, while the satellite, while doing all the process. Thank you so much, sir. Now the floor is open for faculty members. If the faculty member wants to interact with sir, they can please interact. Faculty members, please.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Amit Abhishek. And sir, I want to ask, sir, what are the different types of antenna that we can use in satellite communications?
Very good question. In case of satellite antennas, basically that antennas can be classified in two parts. One for the Earth station, another for the satellite point of view. So in case of satellite point of view, antennas used for satellite point of view, that are the Gregorian antennas, yes, are preferably used in the satellite communication space platform or space segment, where Gregorian antenna is nothing but just a parabolic antennas. Parabolic antennas fit with the horn antenna, because horn antenna is having very high directivity, high gain, and that antenna is fit to the parabola, where parabola again narrow that particular beam and increasing the intensity. So Gregorian and some lens antennas are also useful for the satellite point of view, for the broadcasting purpose and communication purpose. And for the TTCM, because satellite is having two type of antennas, one for the broadcasting and communication, another one for the monitoring. So that TTCM is connected with VHF antennas. So basically, this VHF antennas are the dipole or monopole antennas. So for VHF communication, satellite use monopole or dipole antenna. And for the communication or broadcasting purpose, they are using the cast grain or Gregorian antennas for broadcasting. And on the Earth station, most of the antennas are parabolic antennas with inset feed, offset feed, and Cassegrain is also useful for the Earth stations. So, but most common antenna for Earth station is the offset pad parabolic antenna, where is the parabola, and LNA is had at the offset value. As you can see in the TTH, we are having one dumbbell shape of the structure, dumbbell shape of component, which is the LNB. LNB is basically low noise broadband amplifier. So purpose of LNB, when you open that LNB, then you will find one horn antenna inside that LNB, and then RF filter and amplifier. So that horn antenna is basically feeder to satellite, because parabola is nothing. Parabola is just reflector. Main antenna is the horn antenna. Horn antenna either feed or receive the EM signal, and that EM signal is reflected back by the parabola to the Earth station. So initially, that parabola antenna was center fed, and that feeding point of that horn was at the focus of that parabola, and thereafter, this type of antenna is modified to offset feed, because in this case, there is a problem. If any signal is coming from this direction, that signal is blocked by this LNB. But in case of offset, maximum signal, because maximum signal is coming from line of sight direction. So maximum signal is coming from the center direction, and that will be concentrated over the LNB. So mostly
thank you, sir.
Wired antennas, parabola antennas. and land antennas are also.
Sir, yes. Is there any possibility to develop antenna on board?
On board antenna, of on course. Board. Of course, of course, of course. For intercept communication, like if we are having only one VHF antenna for TTCM, and that one VHF antenna is transmitted through the earth segment. But inside the body, there are larger number of monitoring equipment, larger number of sensors, like temperature sensors, voltage sensors, control, voltage monitoring, current temperature and current monitoring, and vibration monitoring. So all this data is received by the onboard antennas. That onboard antennas are basically printed antennas. And that, but that printed antennas are having one disadvantage of that. They are only capable to transmit signal for the short distance. That's why that onboard antenna is transmitting their signal to their one VHF antenna. So different sensors are communicated with that onboard antenna, and onboard antennas are transmitting to VHF antenna, and that VHF antenna is transmitted to the TTCM. So onboard antennas are also possible, and most of the onboard antennas are designed on the X-band. While that X-band signal is just transformed to VHF and then transmitted.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Good afternoon, Ankur, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, myself, Ankur. There is one question from my side, sir. What are the carrier opportunities which we will be having from electronics domain in satellite communication oriented jobs and research kind of stuff?
Right. So, more than 50% part of satellite belongs to electronics. That means purpose of satellite is what? It's a communication. And very few part related to the mechanical structure and electrical property belongs to the electrical and mechanical, like physical body structure, rotation of the antennas, that belongs to mechanical part. And the power supply part is belongs to the electrical. Rest of the complete analysis belongs to electronic and communication, like designing of, suppose you want to design any RF module, and that RF module is designed by the RF engineer, electronic engineer. That communication module is designed by the RF engineer, electronics RF engineers. And the carrier aspects in this electronics and communication is in India, we are having the ISRO, NASA, DRDO, all are designing that launching vehicles. And because that launch vehicle is just modified form of missile. Because launching satellite launching is only possible due to the missile technology. So the DRD is also designing some part of launching vehicle, and ISRO is designing for communication point of view. ISRO is having their different center for different part, like SEC center of Ahmedabad is designing only antenna parts and antenna and mixer part. So antenna is completely defined on the SEC ISRO. Other private organizations are also there. Some private agencies are also now involved in the space agency. In India also, they plan to start the private organization coming in the field of satellite communication. And one of the biggest company, SpaceX agency, that is the private agency. And that is launching more and more satellites compared to the NASA. So it's a large aspect and large carrier options are available in case of satellite communication.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, I think questions are over from the student side as well as from the faculty member side. So, on the behalf of Sir Government Engineering College, Vaishali, I would like to present my gratitude and thank you to you for sharing your precious time for our student. Actually, sir, student were from past 6 months, they are asking for a talk on this topic. So I would like to really thank you for giving such a nice presentation. The presentation is absolutely conveying, and the student are, we are getting the student response, and they are sharing the response. They are really very happy and they are feeling learned from your presentation. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation. And thank you all the faculty members for sharing the time, and all the students for listening to us on YouTube platform and on other platform. So with the permission of respected Ritesh sir, I think we should end the session if sir yes. allows.
Of course.
Thank you, Ritesh sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.